Yo, are my curls popping?
Not my eyebrows. Okay, so welcome back to my channel. Today I am gonna be talking about When They See Us and the Kalief Browder story and basically police brutality in jail while I do my hair. So basically, When They See Us, right, if you have not seen it, then you are late. It's the story about the Central Park Five, where five teenage boys were wrongly, basically, like, I don't want to say executed, because don't execute mean like they kill you or something. I don't really know, but they were wrongly imprisoned and criminalized over a crime that they did not do. And then the killer actually ended up coming out and saying that he did it. Which was crazy to me because when I was like watching it, and the guy, I don't remember his name, but I know that he got into a fight with Corey. And then like, I don't know if it was the same episode, but later on you see that he was the one that killed him. And I'm like, I was shook because it was kind of like, the way like the scenes happened and everything, I was like, oh my gosh, what's happening? And then they like made up and everything, and I was just shocked. Okay, so I have to say that watching, I know a lot of people aren't, well, don't want to watch it, or like they watch it and they feel really bad about it that they can't even watch it, you know, and a lot of people are scared to watch it. All I have to say is just watch it. Like, I mean, luckily we're not watching the real thing with how everything happened, but watch it, have your kids watch it if they, you know, can understand it and everything like that, and talk to your kids about it, especially our boys. I feel like we need to be talking to them, and you know, it's hard, but the world out there is cruel, and especially to us black people. I feel like the more that these stories get told, the better it would be for our community to kind of realize things and help each other out, basically. So I do have to give my props to the cast. It was an amazing series. Honestly, when it came out, I was gonna watch it for a while, basically, like I was with Black Panther. But you know what? Let me watch this right now. We're amazing actors, especially Jarrell Jerome. And I remember watching it, I was like, oh my god, that's the dude from Moonlight who's out here kissing the boy. So, and then I also found out that he was in another movie I watched, but you know, he did a good job. Like, I could not tell the difference between the kid and the adult because he, like, you know, grew out a beard and everything like that, and the wigs that they had on them. But it was, like, cool to see how his acting changed from kid to adult. And then when you watch, like, a Corey Wise interview, you can tell that he took his time to study Corey and study his, what's this called? Mannerisms, I think. Mannerisms, Mataracs, something like that. He like took his time to study it, and you honestly have to give your props to them. And then Kevin, but he was so cute with his little eyelashes. I just want to point out that one thing that I noticed was how a lot of them did not have fathers in their lives, dads in their lives, which was sad to see. But it was also crazy to see how when they needed their dads the most, their dads kind of dipped on them, you know. Like, Anton's dad made him lie. And then I feel like Raymond's dad just kind of gave up on him. They didn't really have no one else except their moms. And then Yusef's mom was, like, being kind of rude. Like, I cannot believe that she did that. Because even if my son did not do as bad as a crime, or he's not in, a bigger jail or whatever, like, I get it and I understand it. It was, like, surprising to me because if that was me, and everybody's not me, but I definitely would have stuck with the mom and had my son talk to his friend. I don't even know the lady's name anymore. Linda. I don't remember her name. But she, okay, so I was like kind of confused because it was Linda and then it was that other lady with the red hair. But they was both just getting on my nerves because how you gonna sit here and try and falsify crime? Like, they were like, what if we move up the time? What if we say they're over there, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, you're this. Press. To sit here and be lying on these boys when their stories, A, don't correlate and don't make sense. Like, you're that pressed. I don't know how much money they'd be making if they close the case or something, but it's got to be a lot for her to be doing all that. Millimeter kicking, thinking about what the street do to me, cause they never taught peace in the black community. All we know is violence, do the job in silence. Walk the city streets like a rat pack of tyrants. Too many brothers, daily headed for the big pen. Niggas coming out worse off than when they went in. Over the years I've done a lot of growing up, get drunk, throwing up, cuffed up, then I said I had enough. There must be a... Cause at the end of the day, that's wrong. And it's wrong that they do this all of the time. I don't get it. Why would you sit here and falsify these five teenage boys instead of going out there and finding the real killer who actually ended up killing even more women? That's why, too, it's important that we kind of keep our kids out of the system in some ways. That's honestly sad, because to me it's like, why do the police spend so much time in the hood minding our business when they should be out there doing other stuff? Like, I don't know, they could be fixing up schools. They could be out here giving actual people tickets out here who be road raging, following each other. Like, come on. If y'all out here so much, why don't y'all actually do some work and help people fix it up and help people get some jobs and stuff? So basically, if you don't know, Kalief Browder was also falsely in prison, and he actually ended up taking his life. And he was falsely in prison for stealing a backpack. A backpack. He spent about 3 years in prison. He was 16 and he got out when he was about 19. And he told them, like, he didn't steal no backpack. He wasn't there. Him and his friend was coming home from a party at, like, 1 or 2 in the morning. But he didn't know nobody with the backpack. And then the dude that said that they stole his backpack couldn't even really identify them. But that's what the cops do. They sit here and they go into your brain and tell you, like, yeah, that's him, that's him. Or they sit here and go into your brain just like they did with the Central 5 and tell you to say this and say that so that you can go home. That's crazy. Like, for what? But Kalief Browder also spent time at Rikers Island. There's a series on Netflix. If you haven't watched it, go watch it. I will put, like, the picture. Go watch it. It's really good. It's like his mom and his sister and brothers just talking about everything. So, but he also spent time at Rikers Island, just like Corey did. And at Rikers Island, I think it's like one of the most dangerous prisons in New York or in the country or something like that. And when you're 16 in New York, you get trialed as an adult. That is crazy to me, because if the law says that at 18 you're an adult, why are you trying someone at 16? Anyways, whatever. And it's just really sad, because as you guys saw, Corey got beat up and so did Kalief Browder. Kalief, I seen in the series, there's like actual footage. It's kind of crazy how, because at Rikers Island, it's mostly teenagers there, and the teenagers run stuff. So the guards would try and get them to beat up people who didn't comply. I forgot what they called it, but it's like this system where you had to agree to, like, sneak stuff in and, like, what can you do for the guards, blah, blah, blah. And Kalief did not. He was like, I'm not part of that. So because he said he wasn't part of it, they ended up beating him up multiple times. I just think it's crazy how they set these bonds so high so that they know that our people that are going to jail are poor, so they know that they cannot get out. So they set the bonds so high. You're keeping me in jail because I'm poor. For what? That's wasting space, it's wasting time, and it's wasting people's lives. And then he ended up going, he kept like going to trial. And trial and trial and trial. They kept denying him like a trial day after day after day. He took a plea and they would have let him out, but he was like, no, I didn't do it, I'm not taking a plea. So then he would go back to the prison, keep getting beat up, and then he would go into solitary confinement. Solitary confinement is people, if you hear stories, people go crazy in solitary confinement. These people are locked in cages. They can't talk to anyone. And then also too, because Rikers Island is like on a whole nother section of New York, a lot of times, like, especially Kalief's mom, she couldn't really travel as much because she couldn't afford it, and like she had like a bad heart, so she couldn't keep walking around and going on buses and like all of that stress on her. She couldn't like keep doing, she couldn't go see him like every day. So then they don't see their parents. They're only 14, 15, 16, 17 years old, having to go through all this. They had poop on the walls, blood everywhere. People was getting cut up. And also at Rikers Island, there's no white people there. So whenever a white inmate goes to Rikers Island, they will hurry up and get that inmate out. And it's just crazy to me how I feel like us as a society, we put us against each other. So we put our women against each other, we put our men against each other, and then even worse, we put our men against our women against our men. So it's crazy to me how in that prison, they were putting the boys against each other. So when I seen that Corey went to Rikers Island to that part, I was like, because I already knew what happened with Kalief, and I could only imagine what happened with him, especially since they were, you know, they made him say that he raped a woman. So when I heard that, honestly though, surprisingly, throughout the whole series, I didn't cry. But when I heard that, like, my heart just broke and it sank. Just hearing that and seeing them have to go through all of that. Like, they didn't know what none of that stuff meant. They don't know what a trial means. They don't know what it's like to, like, actually go to jail, go to court. They were just trying to go out with their friends, you know what I'm saying? And they was trying to have fun. And then all of a sudden, it turned into that. And I just dislike how they all assume that the black guys did it. Like, okay, just because they was running around harassing people don't really mean nothing. And I only saw them beat up one person. The other people, all I know is that they was running in between them. So that's not harassment. But why are you running in the woods dark when it's dark outside? I feel like that was like one of the things that my grandmother kept emphasizing, you know. The way directed it, and she, like, when she was like running into the woods, I was like, you see, I'm not saying she deserved it or nothing, but I'm just saying, like, I don't know, maybe she wanted to release some stress, maybe she wanted to see some animals or something. I get it. I feel like if it didn't get told, people wouldn't really see how bad the system is, especially seeing how they kept on, like, taunting the boys and kept getting in their face and stuff. Like, these are little kids, like, that you are taunting and wanting them to sit here and say that they raped a woman, like, legit raped and beat her up and stuff. Like, them boys was like this small, honestly. And I'm actually pretty surprised that the jury found them guilty, because when you actually, like, watch the scenes, I don't think they should have had, there was no DNA. They even showed and tested the DNA on the sock or something like that, and it said that it didn't match any of the five boys. So at that point, I was like, okay, case closed. But they still found them guilty because they're black kids, they're black boys in New York. And they had the stop and frisk where they were like, stop random boys, Hispanic and black boys on the street, and just, what's this called, pat them down, whatever. Crazy. Why? Because I didn't really understand how bad the prison system was until, like, I heard about Meek Mill. You hear Meek Mill talk about it, about fixing it, but, like, you never think that people that are supposed to protect you would do this. But then, as I kept, like, watching stuff, reading stuff, I was like, honestly, by the time I watched When They See Us, I was not even surprised, because I was like, the police and jails was started to incarcerate black people, whether they were innocent or not. At the end of the day, that's why it was started. It wasn't started to, like, oh, protect the people and, like, oh my gosh, America. No, it was to protect white people, basically. And as we all know, there's politicians and cops that are in the KKK. War on drugs was started to incriminate black people. So to me, another thing is with the prison system, they keep incarcerating, like, all of these people. They say, like, oh my gosh, the hood is bad and people in the hood deserve to go to jail, they're criminals and stuff like that. Then why aren't you fixing it? And why do you keep saying that when y'all are the ones that did that? Like, the government are the ones that did it. The government are the ones that put in the drugs, and they're the ones that basically didn't care to fix up these neighborhoods. So why do y'all keep saying that if y'all not gonna do nothing about it? Y'all keep locking up all these people for dealing marijuana, dealing crack cocaine, and all of this stuff, which I understand, like, drugs are drugs. But at the end of the day, why are you incarcerating them when you should be incarcerating yourself? Because y'all was the ones that gave it to us.
You are going to jail! Period!
feel like the more that we watch this stuff and the more that we confront it, the more that we're able to change it and fix it slowly but surely. Our schools are preparing our kids for jail. They're not only in, what am I saying? They're not only preparing our kids to be employees and to not think for themselves, but they are preparing our kids for jail. And the reason why I say that is because you go to elementary schools, you go to middle schools, even high schools, you know, and they have to walk in lines. I mean, high school, you know, but you have to walk in lines. The food that they serve, come on, it's like probably 20% better than actual jail food, but it's still jail food. The bell system, and then, like, if you walk into my sister's school, it looks like a jail. Like, you go in the middle and you look around, it has like three floors. You look around, it looks like a jail. It looks like cells. Like, the class dorm rooms look like cells. You look at the school to prison pipeline, and you can see that a lot of kids, when they come out of school, they're destined to go to prison basically in some neighborhoods. Maybe if y'all put some time into teaching our kids, they wouldn't. But no, in solitary confinement, like, a lot of people lose their minds. And it's sad because then when they come out, they're just, especially from Rikers Island, I know, they're just dropped off. Like, they go on the bus and they just get dropped off the bus onto the street. Like, what's in there for a long time? They kind of, you lose a sense of society, you lose a sense of the outside world, you lose a sense of yourself, and then you just gonna take these people and drop them off on the street. They don't know where to go. They don't probably done forgot where their house is at. Kalief Browder, he just got dropped off. He had to, like, all of a sudden learn all this new stuff, you know, and he says it like he was like, I gotta learn how to get a job. And then he also was very depressed at home. You know, especially, and then people, he had like schizophrenia. He developed it just being in solitary confinement. But he basically, he thought like people were coming for him. He heard voices in his head. And then, like, for real, cops were like following him because he was trying to tell his story. They didn't want him to tell his story. So he tried to kill himself. I know he tried to kill himself in at Rikers. And then the guards sat there and just let him do it. Like, I'm gonna kill myself, I'm gonna kill myself, I need to see a psychiatrist. And it was like, no. One day, you know, he was sitting there, he was like, I'm gonna hang myself, and they basically told him, like, do it. He did it, and then they just stood there and watched. Actually, towards the end, that was when they went in there and started to beat him up. You had to think too, like, these are kids. Like, even Corey got beat up, and these are kids that don't, their brains are still forming. They don't understand a lot in the world. They think they do, but we don't. That's also too why, I think in an interview, Jarrell said that he, when he talks to Corey, like, he could still see that 16-year-old kid in him. How Khalif's mom was, you know, the bond was like 1500, I think. She couldn't pay it, and Khalif was like, okay, well, maybe if you go to neighbor, you know, they try to figure stuff out. And then by the time that his mom got the bond, they were like, oh, he can't be taken out. They like put something on his records, and it was like, oh, he don't have bond. And it's like, what do y'all do with bond money anyways? I truly want to know, what do y'all do with it? You, all these bonds, you know, there's 50K bonds, 100K bonds, million bonds. What do y'all do with the money? Because it ain't going to the prisons, I'll let you know that much. Why do I have to pay money for my freedom? Why do I have to pay money if I didn't do anything? Why do I have to pay money to get out of this place when I'm telling you I did not do it? Why do I have to pay money when you have no evidence against me? It's all a money game, and I feel like it doesn't have to be. Like, prison, in prison, people that actually deserve to be in prison, stop trying to worry about us and trying to imprison us and start imprisoning people that actually deserve it. These cops that are out here killing people, these school shooters, these people that y'all say have like mental illnesses, and then the people that actually have real mental illnesses, y'all are not helping. Or let me say this, the black people that have mental illnesses, y'all are not helping. NW Melly, right? He says he has ADHD, bipolar, and did. You're not helping them at all. You're like just throwing them in jail just to be in jail, but you're not getting them any type of help. I have this theory that by not legalizing marijuana in all 50 states, they are just keeping our men imprisoned. And they, you know, like I said, it's making them more money. And if they make marijuana legal, they'll have to release a lot of people. These people would go to jail for having like an ounce on them, or a little bit more than that. With the war on drugs too, remember y'all, if you had powder cocaine, you would only get like a tenth of the years of someone that had actual crack cocaine. AKA powder cocaine was the white people's cocaine, crack cocaine was black people's cocaine, basically. Can you smoke cocaine? Just to like sit here and see how the system is taking our kids, our people, in their innocence, their childhoods, their lives. I thank everyone that's talking about it and people that are trying to do something about it. You know, like Kim Kardashian, she's a whole nother topic though, because she doing this stuff, but then she's sitting there disrespecting Jordan and stuff. Like, y'all love black men, but not black women. Let me stop. To the government, like, who are y'all to say that y'all could just take these kids? Who are y'all to say that y'all could just take, like, who are y'all? Y'all are not God. As much as white people in authority think they're God, y'all are not God. I am sorry. I don't know. And it's also crazy to me how Linda really wanted these boys locked up because they were black. Like, okay, so you're telling me that if you would have actually found out and found the rapist and say, per se, he was white, right? You know, like your ancestors used to do. Then would that look bad, like what, on your part, whatever? And then even when the dude came and said like I did it, they did not do it, they still did not believe him. He's telling y'all everything that happened, but y'all want these dudes 7 to 12 years locked up for not doing the crime that they did. I'll be damned. Especially because they're cops, they can basically do whatever they want, unfortunately, as we see, because don't nobody care about black women, black men, black kids, blah blah blah. They don't care until someone shed light on it, like with the whole Mr. Robert situation. Like, how dare y'all not sit here and take what happened seriously back in the day with Mr. Robert because they're black women. And that's another thing too. No one's gonna stick up for us except for us, because we have to get these things in the light. And that's exactly, you know, keep them coming, keep the documentaries coming, keep the movies coming, because I'm excited to keep learning and keep seeing about what's happening with us in the government, because the government is a scam. They don't want you to know that. They think that we're stupid, and to be honest, we fall for it. A lot of us fall for it. If you're a cop, you know what comes with that. And you can't sit here and say like, oh, I thought his cell phone was a gun. Y'all not trained to actually like learn what guns look like. How does someone's cell phone look like a gun? And why are you not trained with your eyes to see what a gun looks like? And then, like, in the hate they give, I don't think that's a true story, but I know that he had his hairbrush and he like started brushing his hair back, and the cop thought it was a gun. If it was a gun, why would I be brushing my hair with a gun? Like, y'all, sometimes, listen, like I said, I know it's a hard job, but sometimes y'all gotta think, okay? If I am in the window seat of my car brushing my hair back, I'm not turned towards you pointing it or nothing, how do you think that's a gun? You think I'm over here brushing my hair with a gun before I'm about to shoot you or something? I don't know about y'all, but I don't think that's how these people be out here killing each other. But because of our skin color, our boys are seen as a threat, our men are seen as a threat, and it sucks because women like me out here sticking up for y'all, and then y'all don't even respect your woman back, but whatever. But yeah, I just want to say, protect your boys, hide your kids, hide your wife, hide everybody. How does it go? I just want to say that I'm here for all of you guys. If you ever want to DM me or email me or whatever about anything, we could talk about anything. So protect, let's all protect each other, like especially us. I feel like we stick up for everything else, America, other than black people. that built this country. America will go so hard for all these other oppressed people except for black people. I'm in this video because my sister is playing music and stuff. I just hope you guys enjoyed it, and I hope, like I said, that you guys watch it. It's an amazing movie. All of it's amazing. You know what I'm saying? Black Netflix is the best Netflix. So all of it's amazing, and I hope that you guys watch it, and I hope that you guys enjoy this video. I want to speak on more black topics, so if you want to leave them in the comments or DM me or something, that would be nice too. And I just want you guys to stay tuned to my next video. Subscribe and follow me on Instagram. And yeah, just have a great day, a great weekend, a great life. Be careful out here, y'all. Stay safe, stay careful. And I hope that you guys enjoyed. Bye.